Am I audible now?
Yeah. I pay my respect to all the elders and the complete audience who is attending this program. I thought since this is a Sanskrit Samvardhan Samshodhan conference, I should begin with a Sanskrit shloka. The traditional dance has always had its, has never lost its relationship with Sanskrit compositions as well as Sanskrit texts. This shloka is unique. We dancers many times commence our performances with this shloka. Angikam bhuvanam yasya vachikam sarva vangmayam aharyam chandra taragi tam numa satvikam shivam. Angik, vachik, aharyam and satvi. These are four types of abhinaya, four sides or aspects of abhinaya, which right from Bharata has been accepted, and we do use them in solo style like Bharatanatyam. The Vachika and Aharya, everything we convey through dance. So the Angika is the whole universe, the movement of the whole universe is his body. Vachika, what he speaks is all Vangmai, that is for him, his speech. And Aharya is no ordinary Aharya. He wears moon and serpents and the garland of skulls and such a Shiva. He expresses from his heart, he is Sattvika in that sense. So he personifies all the four Abhinayas for us. And so I thought I would begin with this shloka, Sanskrit shloka.
Very true, Thai. This is a very beautiful start to this because Sanskriti is all aspect of Sanskriti, and art is a very, very important part of Sanskriti. And that is what we are trying to do, to take Sanskriti in all aspects ahead to the common people, so that, they would, all aspects, most of the time research remains locked inside theses and inside institutions, but it is necessary that this research comes out to the common people and they know the real essence of it. And that is why we thought it would be really nice to have a researcher, a guru, and a real exponent to be with us. So welcome once again on behalf of Sanskriti Samvardhan and Samshodhan Pratishthan. So Thai, you can have a little bit of water because I know it is difficult at the age of 70, but you don't even look it, and the performance doesn't even show that it is so lively. So I would like to begin by first of all asking a very very simple thing, that is, we have a long tradition of Bharatanatyam. that has been there for, for centuries. And it has gone, it has traversed, it has moved from different forms, right, from the temple to the stage now. And yet you have worked so much with Bharatanatyam, and you have also developed a style of your own. So there has been a transition, obviously, from Bharatanatyam to this new style, which, of course, I'm sure you would want to tell everyone about it. But can you tell me first about, tell our audience first about your early days of experimenting and researching in Bharatanatyam?
Well, initially, I would say it's not been transition. It's, I would say, what probably I've tried to do is addition. Because parampara takes whatever is there and then assimilates it with the existing times and then goes ahead. This is what happened in with me. The whole thing, actually, if you ask me, it all started when I was still studying with my guru, Acharya Parvati Kumar. And he came across Marathi compositions written for Bharatanatyam. This was way back in early 70s. And it was to his surprise that a book from Saraswati Mahal came to his hands. And he saw that they were all like traditional compositions, like Alar Puja Tiswaram Varanam Shabdam and so on. But the Sahitya was not Tamil, Telugu, but all Sanskrit, but it was Marathi. This interested him, and he went to Tanjore and he did work there, did research, and found out many of the manuscripts which are still lying in Saraswati Mahal Library. Of course, since then, a lot of Marathi compositions have also been published. But then this was the Korvyache Sahityache Jinnas. This was the only publication of Marathi compositions. It was my fortune, and probably at that time I was his only ready disciple, and he could also feel my interest in the theoretical aspect. So he made me part of this work, his research work, and I got the complete idea how the whole thing was restructured. He got a musician, Janardhan Pantanjorkar, who was a vainika and a singer, and he knew Marathi as well as Tamil. He is from a family which migrated, family of Devadasis who migrated from Tanjavur to Baroda. And so he knew Marathi language as well as he was settled in Mumbai. So he was the one who, according to the ragas and talas prescribed for the composition, he got them into music, and then Parvati Kumar, of course, he choreographed all these compositions, and almost more than 30-40 compositions I learned initially. The first performance of these Marathi compositions, but they were set to Carnatic music because he felt originally they were in Carnatic music. But for present times, even in 70s, this idea was totally different, totally new. People even felt this was kind of hoax. So we were invited by Bombay Union of Journalists, and we presented, Masterji presented, I danced, and he explained how all this treasure was hidden in Saraswati Mahal Library. And as you know, the Maratha history of Shivaji and his soldiers and the fight for freedom, all that is known to us. But equally important is what these his brethren in Tanjore, Venkoji was Shivaji's elder stepbrother. So the whole family, about 12 rulers ruled there. So all this history and the compositions I inherited. For a long, long time, I was performing till almost late 70s or mid 70s. I was performing them continuously, and I danced them all over Maharashtra. So I think that helped in kind of letting our own people closer to this style, Bharatanatyam, which is of course the tradition was nurtured, developed in South, in Tamil Nadu, in and around Thanjavur. But as our audiences became more and more familiar, these more and more questions were coming forth. And now people started saying, you are using Marathi and Hindi and Sanskrit. When Shahaji, Venkoji's eldest son, he was a linguist and a musicologist, and he has written compositions in Marathi, Sanskrit, and many languages. In fact, he has written a play which incorporates five languages, Pancha Bhasha Vilas. The Naikas are one Marathi speaking, Hindi, Sanskrit, Tamil, and Telugu. So my audiences now started asking that, because in present times, I used to, of course, explain in Marathi and people would feel, oh, really? But as these Marathi compositions were being sung in Carnatic music, which is still, I would say, not at a common level, people don't hear Carnatic music. Their ears are more akin to Hindustani music. So my audiences started saying, your dance is good and we like it and this, but then why don't you use our music? Our music in the sense Hindustani music. In present times, I felt the question was relevant, but answering it was definitely difficult.
So obviously that would mean you having to look for something or develop or rather synthesize music for the dance. Means creating a new style is one thing in dance, and creating yet another music or a system, or not exactly a system, but something which will cause a good amalgamation of the two and be very presentable, sounding nice to the ear and a treat to the eyes. That must have been very challenging.
Yes, Ruchita, you are a dancer, so you definitely know how challenging it was. I love Bharatanatyam. I love it, and I have all the time I had danced only Bharatanatyam, Carnatic music. I learned Carnatic music. I tried to learn Tamil languages, Telugu script, to do all this, to assimilate all the research of my guru, and also to further it by bringing up King Shahaji's Hindi compositions as well. But then now I felt I didn't want to lose the identity of Bharatanatyam body language. At the same time, I wanted to assimilate it with Hindustani classical music, and it really was challenging. It was so initially what I thought was I must identify by really what do we mean by Bharatanatyam? What does it stand for? Is it only the long plait and the big hairdo and the dress and the South Indian kind of ornaments? Is it that? What is it? So I realized that it has, I found out that it has five basic elements, which today I call them as Panchatattvas of Bharatanatyam, because they are what make the aesthetics or the style of Bharatanatyam. These five in short are basically, we apply the ayata of our leg position is always square leg position. And then we involve both the pure rhythmic dance as well as the dance with abhinaya, nrutta and nrutya. And because we utilize the total body language, our forte is medium speed. We might go faster in footwork, but our body movements are always in slow and medium tempo to bring out the grandeur of the style. We, in a performance, we have Rati, Vatsalya, Bhakti. Love, prema is the all-encompassing emotion for humanity. And these are the three forms which do occur in a full recital. And then the principle of margam. That is a chronology of presenting compositions in a way that finally it leads to Rasanishpati. So I felt, if I preserve all these five elements in my new performance with Hindustani music, it should not be, I felt, I don't like too much the word fusion, where you can, you know, kind of try to fuse two different kinds of things also could be fusion. I felt that it should be synthesis. So I maintain the aesthetics of Bharatanatyam, but also the audio, it is an audio visual. And through my training and watching dancers like Bala Saraswati, and after Parvati Kumar, Acharya Parvati Kumar, I also had training from a traditional guru, Guru Kittappa. So all this had inculcated in me that feeling that dance is visual music. So I wanted to now react more to Hindustani classical, but at the same time, maintain the same principles that a Bharatanatyam body language gives us. So initially, you can imagine, what did I try, Ruchita?
So I think actually, would it be time to see one of it so that we actually get to, you know, the audience will get to look at get a more visual feel of the music and the sahitya and the movements, and also understand the pancha tattvas in some form with a visual.
Initially, I thought to dance the Natya Geets, because yes, Natya Sangeet is like how my experiment started. I felt that Natya Sangeet, even today, after we have Maharashtra has rich 100-year-old Natya Sangeet tradition, it's again getting a boom nowadays. But even not only my generation, but even next generation, though we haven't seen the plays, we haven't seen Bal Gandharva and the actors of this time in action, the singer actors, but still we love the song. So I selected songs from mostly the old musical plays where either social, historical. So the Nayak Nayika Bhav, which is very important for projection in a style like Bharatanatyam. So I chose songs from Saubhadra, Manapman, Bhavabandhan, which bring in the aspect of Nayika Bhav. So I shall be presenting one Natya Geet from where really my research, presentation of my research book started. This song is from Bhavabandhan of Ram Ganesh Gadkari. The Nayika, it's little difficult to explain it in English. Katina, Katina, Katina Kiti, Purusha Rudaya Vai. See, the lovers, they meet, they become one, so to say. But there are times when they act totally adverse, and one doesn't understand each other. And then the Nayika is annoyed and says, look, these men, they have heart, very hard heart, like Katrina, Katrina, bahut kathin hai inka dil, ye kuch nahi samajhte hai, kabhi kabhi itni achhi sweet baatein karenge aur kabhi kabhi sab wo tod ke chale bhi jayenge. So this is a kind of I wouldn't say real anger, but said in a mock anger and annoyance.
That's right.
So we'll see this Natya Geet.
Yes, sure.
Thank you.
To digest this fact, considering it is more Abhinaya Pradana, because Abhinaya in any form can be presented since it's based on the Natya Shastra or a text. But I'm sure Thai must have faced a lot of challenges when it came to Shuddha Nritya. So let us wait for her to be back and we can then ask her what it was when it came to Shuddha Nritya. Thai, things are easier when it comes to Abhinaya because there is Sahitya, you can depict it, you can use Sancharis. But I'm sure the bigger challenge is when it comes to the Shuddha Nritya aspect. Yeah. So
I feel that for our girls, this kind of expression can come naturally because we live it. But the more challenging part was naturally the nritya part, because basically tala is same like tala five jati, but Carnatic music system follows a totally different mark, sudadi tala system, and in Hindustani it's different. So that was one thing Also, initially, of course, when Hindustani music, I had thought of tabla. But then also came the realization that for a small, solid kind of footwork, it was the, what is called the pitasas of tabla. Pakhavas was more apt. I must say that initially, in all my thoughts, I felt that this should not be just dancing some compositions in Hindustani, but I had to structure the whole, because Margam is the most important, one of the Panchatattvas of Bharatanatyam presentation. So I had to create a Margam for this, my synthesis. By this time, I had also started thinking, initially we used to call it Bharatanatyam to Hindustani music. But then people probably looked for what they were used to see Bharatanatyam. So that could, you know, lead to, well, this from Bharatanatyam is not here, this from Bharat. So I thought that I should give it, now it's a different thing, so I should give it a...
identity, a new identity.
Nomenclature. But before even I thought of nomenclature, came this idea of Margam. And I thought I should have something like Alarupu Jatishwaram or something like Shabdam and Varnam. And then, of course, the Padams. And Tilana actually came to Hindustani music, to Carnatic music with influence of Tarana. So that's not a problem. But creating compositions, I feel that the real essence of the original cannot come in the translation or transliteration. So what I thought was creating a parallel system. So this idea, I must say that Dr. Prabhatre, Pandit Suresh Tavalkar, Pandit Vasantrao Deshpande, Arjun Sejwarji, they all showed belief in my ideas. Vasantra used to say, yes, do it, Suchita, do it. It will happen. So they all showed faith in my ideas that such margam can be created. So initially, I thought in Pakhavaj, what could be Pakhavaj player when they start playing? They start with Prastar. That is the, even one of the Dasha Pranas, it is Prastar in Sanskrit text. So Prastar is a slightly open, wider framework of the given tal. So I thought I should prepare, but in dance, in Prastar, of course, they do a lot of development and then go ahead in the minor, minutest details of that tal cycle. But then I thought if I had to create compositions parallel, then samskaran was necessary. Because this also came through my search and my study of Carnatic compositions. There is no Alarippu in Carnatic concert, but there is Varnam in Carnatic kacheri, singing concert. But that Varnam is in very fast speed and is sung right in the beginning to prepare the voice. But in dance, we have given it a pride of place, the major place in the Margam. So there is Tana Varnam and there is Pada Varnam, who know about dance music. So I thought some samskaran was needed. So this Prastar, I will just... make a minute version of it. First thing what I needed to do was make a definite composition. It cannot be on the spot or extempore because the Pakhavaj player needs to accompany all the time or play the same thing. So this small Prastar was structured. Those of you who know Bharatanatyam and have seen Alarippu, we'll definitely see the elements. It was also influenced, my choreography of this Prastar was also influenced by a mini Alarippu, which my teacher Kittappa sir had taught me at the beginning to perform at the beginning of the Todai Mangala, which used to be danced in temples. So with all those impressions from the traditional, the study of the traditional, emerged this prastar. I just do a minuscule prastar.
Need creativity, it needs all aspects of understanding everything in depth, not just dance, not just music, the tala paddhati, everything, and at the end of it, it should not look patchwork. This is amazing. This only goes to show that research and research both, because one, you have to search for something new, and then you have to go back to what is there and try to see how it synthesizes with it. So it is research. And true, only a lot of research can come up, can actually lead to this kind of a new creation. I wouldn't say just a new creation, but something which will, which gives you the ability to take it even further, because it doesn't stop at this, obviously. So Tai, no, please catch your breath. Please catch your breath. I'm just thinking aloud of some of these points, because I'm sure our audience, and we have a lot of learned people in the audience who connect either to music, either to instrument, either to dance, and maybe to all. And
I'm happy that at least some examples I can put forward through this program. After Alaripu in Bharatanatyam recital comes Jatishwara.
Correct.
So swaras are used. It is a composition of swaras. Now, even in Carnatic Kacheri, nobody sings Jatishwara. But there is a lot of swaras in the Manodharma Sangita. Sargam is sung liberally.
Okay.
In Hindustani music also. Each rag, as it has Lakshan Geet, it has also Sargam Geet, those of you who have learned Hindustani music. But nobody sings Sargam Geet in concert. So they are part of Lakshan Geet and sort of part of learning process. So now what I thought, but because I had heard quite a bit Dr. Prabhatri, I could see that in some gharanas, they do lot of actually